गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन।
गुड इवनिंग सर।
अच्छा नाउ इन द बिगिनिंग आई वांट टेल यू एन इंटरेस्टिंग थिंग। द कल्चर इन जापान इज सच दैट व्हेन द वर्कर्स आर एंग्री विद द मैनेजमेंट, यू नो इन इंडिया और अदर कंट्रीज व्हाट डू? दे स्टॉप वर्किंग, इजंट इट? इन जापान दे ऑल वेयर ब्लैक बैंड्स एज अ मार्क ऑफ प्रोटेस्ट एंड दे कंटिन्यू टू वर्क, नॉट मेयरली वर्क बट वर्क ओवर टाइम सो दैट इन्वेंट्रीज विल बिल्ड अप and the factory will, the industry will go into losses because it cannot market. So that is their very novel way of protesting. So the manufacturer doesn't stop, the country doesn't suffer, but the management is punished. So that is a very interesting thing which I thought I'd share with you. Now, before I begin today's discussion on the with this article with the title, The Rural Economy Can Jumpstart a Revival, that means a revival of the whole country's economy following this three lockdowns, following the COVID-19 waves, can depend largely on how the rural economy is encouraged and supported. Now, Gandhiji, you must have heard, said India lives in its villages. So that is the importance of the rural areas of the country to the country's economy, social, political, and economic spheres. Now, this article notes that following the second wave beginning to recede all over the country, there are reports that the wave is beginning to recede, and therefore slowly people are thinking about how the economy can be revived. And in Telangana state, as you know, the lockdown has been totally lifted, and we'll have to see how the situation scenario unfolds. Now, the challenge of recovery has now to be faced. Now, the last year the GDP did decline, but not as much as it was feared. Still, it was bound to be a much lower figure in reality than what was reported by the NSSO, etc., because the gross underestimation of the behavior of the unorganized sector is a persisting malady in our system. We do not know what's happening there. Then what makes things even more difficult is that even before the COVID-19 crisis, the country's economy was already in the, for three previous years, it was showing a sharp decline. And with the crisis entering the picture, incomes and employments both took a very bad hit. And since 2016-17, there was a slowdown, which was natural. There was a worldwide slump and all that. But then inept handling by the government of the economy also, according to the author, and I agree with him, made things worse. So the author is also disappointed with the quantum and the nature of support given by the government of India to kickstart the economy after the lockdown. He says that, you know, rightly he points out that most of the support was in terms of monetary measures and without the parallel supporting policy framework being put in place, which is necessary. After all, money itself cannot solve problems. You must know how to manage the impact that it can create. So especially small, medium, and micro industries, there is not enough support given in that particular intervention. And then the unorganized sector has almost completely left out. So peculiarly, in this revival effort, the little revival that we saw, the little, you know, bright patch we saw last year, was unexpectedly and very in a welcome manner, the support came from the agriculture sector, rural sector economy, particularly agriculture. And the other sectors which behaved well last year were electricity, gas, water supply, and utility services. And you all know that many millions of people went back to their villages from the rural areas following unemployment and also the health crisis, and they got jobs in the rural areas. But the author says, and I agree with him, this is hardly likely to continue now unless we take some very aggressive and large scale measures. Not because, I mean, agriculture will not take a hit only because of floods or droughts or something, but also because of the neglect which it has been suffering for over 70 years now. We have discussed it elsewhere, and we also agreed yesterday that one of these days we'll discuss it in full. But a sound policy needs to be put in place now if some visible results has to be seen. And also the non-agricultural sector in the rural areas also is not behaving very well, because there's a visible and discernible fall in demand following the two lockdowns in the urban areas where their goods normally go to. So even the last year's little growth that we noticed is largely because, the growth we may see this year, because the previous year's bases were very slow. So it's not as if it's a very heartening feature. Then the author also says that, like Seema Chishti pointed out the other day, basically, numbers are a big issue in India. The COVID casualties or economic revival figures, none of them is reliable. And another thing that happened, that is a large number of rural families lost earning members, and also you spent huge amounts on Medicare because of this pandemic, and thus a wave of indebtedness has swept over rural India, painting a very grim picture which we must take note of and deal with, is what the author is saying. And the government's response, as I said, he feels that it's been incommensurate. For instance, the National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, the Mahatma Gandhi Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, the allocation is totally inadequate. There's no increase at all. And the free food scheme also has left out pulses, which is an important thing. And therefore, obviously, the number of man days or person days generated by NREGS has also fallen. And then the cash transfer to the vulnerable groups has also not taken place this year, which is sad. They should not have discontinued in a situation like this. Then already agriculture wages were stagnating and non-agriculture wages were declining. And then the COVID-19 situation had made it much worse. Therefore, there's a huge fall in demand, as I said, and wholesale prices of various commodities have been peculiarly, because there's a fall in demand, the wholesale prices realized by the rural economy have been declining. Although at the household level, the inflation has been increasing. Peculiarly, like for instance, if you take commodities like cereals and vegetables, international prices are ruling at an all-time high, naturally, because there's a tremendous shortage. But in India, the farmers are not getting the kind of price they need for their produce. So naturally, there is inflation, and both of which are, because particularly pulses and oil seeds, both are imported. And if you, in a situation like this, it naturally causes, inflation, because it's, you're importing it at a higher rate than you would have been able to, had there been enough production in the country. Then ultimately what's happening is the terms of trade against agriculture, terms of trade, as you know, is the difference between the price you realize and then the price you pay for commodities. For agriculture, it has always been an adverse kind of situation. And this, in this situation, it has become much, much worse. And also, to add to all this, diesel costs have gone up. So that means more input costs for the agriculturist, and fertilizer costs have gone up, which is an essential input for agriculture. So all this is making the farm sector very, very, acutely vulnerable and fragile in this situation. So for any economy, especially India's economy, where nearly 60% and more of the people depend on agriculture for a livelihood, the rural economy is very important, and not only important, it's crucial. So a strategy for revival of the rural economy is what the author is arguing for. And parallelly, he says, you must also look at the health of the rural people, because otherwise, how do you make the rural economy work? So a very rapidly accelerated and large scale vaccination drive is what he is arguing for. And also a greater direct support, income support for the rural people, the poor people, and increased provision of subsidies for, say, things like diesel can be subsidized for agriculture use, and then fertilizer. I am against these untargeted subsidies, but as a short-term measure, I suppose it has to be thought about. So this is roughly what the burden of his song is, which is what I thought I'd share with you my take. And in fact, as you know, this is the right time to recall, perhaps I told you this before, Jawaharlal Nehru said long ago that everything else can wait, but not agriculture. Okay, that is my take. Since make the class a little lively, I thought I'll end with a little problem with some of the students who have attended my earlier classes may be knowing. There are three mugs whose capacities are 8 liters, 5 liters and 3 liters. The 8 liter mug is filled with water. Now, there are two people who must use, these mugs are not calibrated. We only know the total volume that they can carry. In how many operations using these three mugs, pouring water from one to another, can we make two people share 4 liters each? Tomorrow, any student can solve the problem and we can begin the class with that. Meanwhile, I'll be happy to take any doubts, questions, etc.